The interpret, if this is right, and I think it is, the interpretation of verse 12, that it's not too hard for you, is actually to say that it's not the case for you to ascend. Therefore, it's necessary that the Lord will himself descend in order to reverse the curse of the fall, and especially the Adamic curse of the fall. But then verse 13 begins to address how it's not too far off. And it interprets that as, it is not beyond the sea that you should say, who will go over the sea for us and bring it to us, that we may hear and do it. So what does the phrase beyond the sea refer to? A typical commentator say something like this. You don't have to hop into a boat, go across the sea, get it, and bring it back. That's the standard interpretation of this phrase. However, if we are to think about what the crossing of the sea means for the people of God, it's important to note that there's only one other place up to this part in redemptive history where crossing the sea has happened. In fact, there's only one other place in the entire Old Testament up to this point where the combination of the verb avar, to cross over, and yam sea, is seen together in this way, and it's at the crossing of the Red Sea, as it's referenced in Numbers chapter 33, verse 8. So the crossing of the sea there shouldn't be seen in terms of hopping in a boat and crossing the sea to get something and bring it back. It needs to be interpreted in light of the way the Lord works and the crossing of the Red Sea in Exodus 14 and 15. And if we're interpreting it this way, what is the main theme in Exodus 14 and 15? As the people of God are being brought across the sea. The main theme, which is emphasized in Exodus 15, Moses' song about crossing the sea, is actually focused on judgment. Exodus 15, verses 1 to 12, focuses on how the Lord comes as the divine warrior and triumphs gloriously over the hosts of Egypt by casting horse and rider into the sea. Right, how he sent fury out and consumed them like stubble, verse 6. How he sank Egypt like lead in the mighty floodwaters, verse 10. And then in verses 14 to 18, it actually focuses how the Lord is going to do the exact same thing as he comes against the inhabitants of the land. Now, what's important about this to note is that by referencing the crossing of the sea, we have an immediate focus on a theme of judgment. On a theme of judgment building in to restoration. And also, in terms of the crossing of the Red Sea, Voss calls this, and I think he's right, the culminating act in the great drama of redemption, a culminating act in the Exodus event. And as it's coming to a culminating act in this Exodus event, its focus as a pouring out of the judgment curse on the enemies of God leads to our consideration of how we need to be restored to the presence of God to begin with. Because in the crossing of the Red Sea, there are two parties at play in terms of who goes across, right? There's the Egyptians that are judged, and then there's the Israelites that are brought through and are granted life. Because of this context in Exodus chapter 15 and the way that Moses describes it there, the crossing of the Red Sea is a functional death and resurrection narrative, where what's going on in the life of the people of God there is that they are functionally buried. The waters descend over them, and they are washed over in death, and they rise to new life on the other side. So the crossing of the Red Sea in Exodus 15 should see Israel as a type of Christ undergoing death and resurrection onto the other side. It's, as it were, a birthing of the nation, a new nation being brought forth and being granted life.
That's how Paul can speak about being baptized into Moses, the baptism in those waters of judgment. He can also speak about those same themes in Romans 6, for example. This is clearly done in the New Testament. This isn't just injecting things into the Old.
Yeah, not at all. It's something that the New Testament does all over the place.
Yeah,
but it's also something that we need to see the Old Testament as presenting on its own terms.
Exactly. Right.
So the New Testament interprets it that way. And it interprets it that way because the Old Testament is saying it that way.